Thank you. for being here on the 3rd of July. We have a different sort of service today than our regular, what we regularly do on Sunday morning. And to give you sort of the background for how this liturgy came about, I struggled for years and years as a priest figuring out how to find that sweet place between kind of being in worship, proclaiming our lives as followers of Jesus, and yet also recognizing that we're citizens of this country, and how those two things merge together. And quite frankly, for years and years, I struggled with the national hymns at the back of the hymnal, and I fought it, and then when I sort of loosened up in my old age, I'm like, oh, whatever. And so now I'm like embracing it. So we're going to be singing a lot of those hymns. I do encourage you to pay attention to the lyrics, because the lyrics actually of these hymns, they do exactly what we're trying to do in this service of worship, which is to balance that notion that we want to celebrate that we live in a country that aspires to some amazing ideals, but also that we're not quite there yet. And the hymns speak to that. If you read those lyrics carefully, the words really do speak to that. We have a lot of singing and a lot of listening. The good news about this is that there's no sermon today. If the sermon is from Thomas Jefferson and Abraham Lincoln and Martin Luther King Jr. and Emma Lazarus and some great folks like that. So really pay attention to those readings, and I encourage you to take the bulletin home with you so that you can read these over again. Also, there's a lot of singing as well, and only one hymn board is filled up because I ran out of sevens. So if you use the hymn board, use this one over here. I had to clear out all this in order to fill this. So, a few more announcements. One is General Convention is coming up. That's once every 3 years. The representatives from every diocese in the United States come together and to talk about the business of the church. And Margaret Thor, who is our deacon here, is actually a deputy to General Convention. She's going to be leaving at the end of this week to go and represent our diocese. And we are so lucky that she's going to be doing a Facebook Live thing each morning of General Convention. And you can do that, you can sort of tune in about what's going on, what we're talking about, what they're talking about at General Convention by going to our website or YouTubing it, YouTubing St. John in the Wilderness, and then following along. And Margaret will have a little update as to her perspective on what's going on at General Convention. So if you're interested in the larger church and what's going on, and there's a lot going on in the world, and our church is trying to respond to a lot of that, I encourage you to tune in to Margaret's Facebook Live broadcast. A Wild John Club, that's our every Monday. We go from 5 to 5:30, well, it's usually 5 to like 6:30 that we paddle around in White Bear Lake in a canoe or kayak and everything. Tomorrow's the 4th of July, and it's like crazy on White Bear Lake. So we're not going to do it tomorrow because we want to live. And so we're not going to paddle with all these boats going all over the place. So next Monday we'll do that again. Habitat for Humanity, we have a group that is going to be doing a build over in Bayport, and that is in a couple weeks. I've signed up for a day. If you would like to be a part of that Habitat for Humanity, we can get you in touch on our website, and actually the e-news also pointed to where you can volunteer for that. So that's coming up. And lastly, I want to remind you about the parish camping trip, which is coming up at the end of August. So if you want to come for a day or for the full thing, I encourage you to check out those dates and come join us up at William O'Brien State Park. Again, thanks for being here.
and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. Lord God Almighty, in whose name the founders of this country won liberty for themselves and for us, and lit the torch of freedom for nations then unborn, grant that we and all the people of this land may have grace to maintain our liberties in righteousness and peace.
Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
The first reading, first inaugural address, Thomas Jefferson, 1743 to 1846. Thomas Jefferson was an American statesman, diplomat, lawyer, architect, philosopher, and founding father who served as the third president of the United States from 1801 to 1809. He was the principal author of the Declaration of Independence. After a particularly bitter and divisive presidential campaign and election, Jefferson focuses on unifying the country, especially Republicans and Federalists, enumerating his ideas of the principles of government, which include equal rights, preservation of the Constitution, and civil control of the military. Let us then, with courage and confidence, pursue our federal and republican principles, our attachment to union and representative government, kindly separated by nature and a wide ocean from the exterminating havoc of one quarter of the globe, too high-minded to endure the degradations of the others, possessing a chosen country with room enough for our descendants to the thousandth and thousandth generation, entertaining a due sense of our equal right to the use of our own faculties, to the acquisitions of our own industry, to honor and confidence from our fellow citizens, resulting not from birth, but from our actions and their sense of them. Enlightened by a benign religion, professed indeed, and practiced in various forms, yet all of them inculcating honesty, truth, temperance, gratitude, and the love of man, acknowledging and adoring an overruling providence, which by all its dispensations proves that it delights in the happiness of man here and his greatest and greater happiness hereafter. With all these blessings, what more is necessary to make us a happy and a prosperous people? Still, one thing more, fellow citizens, a wise and frugal government, which shall restrain men from injuring one another, shall leave them otherwise free to regulate their own pursuits of industry and improvement, and shall not take from the mouth of labor the bread it has earned. This is the sum of good government, and this is necessary to close the circle of our felicities. Here ends the reading.
Second reading, first inaugural address, Abraham Lincoln, 1809 through 1865. Abraham Lincoln was an American lawyer and statesman who served as the 16th president of the United States from 1861 until his assassination in 1865. Lincoln led the nation through the American Civil War, succeeded in preserving the Union, abolishing slavery, bolstering the federal government, and modernizing the U.S. economy. In his first inaugural address, Lincoln promised not to interfere with the institution of slavery where it existed, and pledged to suspend the activities of the federal government temporarily in areas of hostility. However, he also took a firm stance against secession and the seizure of federal property. Why should there not be a patient confidence in the ultimate justice of the people? Is there any better or equal hope in the world? In our present differences, is either party without faith of being in the right? If the Almighty Ruler of nations, with his eternal truth and justice, be on your side of the North or yours of the South, that truth and that justice will surely prevail by the judgment of this great tribunal of the American people. By the frame of the government under which we live, the same people have wisely given their public servants but little power for mischief, and have with equal wisdom provided for the return of that little to their own hands at very short intervals. While the people retain their virtue and vigilance, no administration, by an extreme of wickedness or folly, can very seriously injure the government in the short space of 4 years. In your hands, my dissatisfied fellow countrymen, and not in mine, is the momentous issue of civil war. The government will not assail you. You can have no conflict without being yourselves the aggressors. You have no oath registered in heaven to destroy the government, while I shall have the most solemn one to preserve, protect, and defend it. I am loath to close. We are not enemies, but friends. We must not be enemies. Though passion may have strained, it must not break our bonds of affection. The mystic cords of memory, stretching from every battlefield and patriot grave to every living heart and hearthstone all over this broad land, will yet swell the chorus of the Union when again touched, as surely they will be, by the better angels of our nature. Here ends the reading.
The third reading is the New Colossus, Emma Lazarus, 1849 to 1887. Emma Lazarus was an American author of poetry, prose, and translations, as well as an activist for Jewish causes. She contributed toward shaping the self-image of the United States, as well as how the country understands the needs of those who immigrate to the United States. Her themes produce sensitivity and enduring lessons regarding immigrants and their need for dignity. The lines of the following sonnet are inscribed on a bronze plate installed in 1903 on the pedestal of the Statue of Liberty. Not like the brazen giant of Greek fame, with conquering limbs astride from land to land, here at our sea-washed sunset gate shall stand a mighty woman with a torch, whose flame is the imprisoned lightning, and her name, Mother of Exiles. From her beacon hand glows worldwide welcome. Her mild eyes command the air-bridged harbor that twin cities frame. Keep, ancient lands, your storied pomp, cries she, with silent lips. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. Here ends the reading.
Fundamental Principle of a Republic by Anna Howard Shaw, who lived from 1847 to 1919. Anna Howard Shaw was a leader of the women's suffrage movement in the United States. She was also a physician and one of the first ordained female Methodist ministers in the United States. She made the following speech during the New York State Equal Suffrage Campaign at the City Opera House in Ottenburg, New York on June 21, 1915. Now, what does it matter whether the woman will vote as their husbands do or will not vote, whether they have time or have not, or whether they will vote for prohibition or not? What has that to do with the fundamental question of democracy no one has yet discovered? But they cannot argue on that. They cannot argue on the fundamental basis of our existence, so that they have to get off on all of these side tricks to get anything approaching an argument. So they tell you that democracy is a form of government. It is not. It was before governments were. It will prevail when governments cease to be. It is more than a form of government. It is a great spiritual force emanating from the heart of the infinite, transforming human character until someday in the distant future, man, by the power of the spirit of democracy, will be able to look back into the face of the infinite and answer as man cannot answer today.
One is our Father, even God, and all we people are the children of one family. No, we women do not want the ballot in order that we may fight, but we do want the ballot in order that we may help men to keep from fighting, whether it is not in the home or in the state, just as the home is not without the man, so the state is not without the woman. And you can no more build up homes without men than you can build up the state without women. We are needed everywhere, for human problems are to be solved. Men and women must go through this world together, from the cradle to the grave. It is God's way, and the fundamental principle of a republican form of government. Here ends the reading.
Please join in the psalm, which we will read responsively by half verse. I will exalt you, O God, my King.
Bless us, your name forever and ever.
Every day will I bless you. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised.
There is no end to his praise.
One generation shall praise your works to another,
and shall declare your power.
I will ponder the glorious splendor of your majesty,
and all your marvelous works.
They shall speak of the might of your wondrous acts. They shall publish the remembrance of your great goodness.
They shall sing of your righteous deeds.
The Lord is gracious and full of compassion.
Slow to anger and of great kindness.
The Lord is loving to everyone.
The fifth and final reading is from Martin Luther King, Now is the Time. Martin Luther King was an American Baptist minister and activist who became the most visible spokesman and leader in the civil rights movement from 1955 until his assassination in 1968. In what many consider one of the greatest speeches ever delivered, King spoke at the Lincoln Memorial on August 28th, 1963, during the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom. He deftly synthesized portions of his earlier speeches into this "I Have a Dream" message of the necessity for change and the potential for hope in America. I'm happy to join with you today in what will go down in history as the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of our nation. 40 years ago, a great American, whose symbolic shadow we stand, signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This momentous decree came as a great beacon light of hope to millions of Negro slaves who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to the end the long night of captivity. But 100 years later, we must face the tragic fact that the Negro is still not free. 100 years later, the life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination. 100 years later, the Negro lives on a lonely island of poverty in the midst of a vast ocean of material prosperity. 100 years later, The Negro is still languishing in the corners of American society and finds himself in exile in his own land. So we have come here today to dramatize an appalling condition. In a sense, we have come to our nation's capital to cash a check. When the architects of our republic wrote the magnificent words of the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, they were signing a promissory note to which every American was to fall heir. This note was a promise that all men would be guaranteed the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. It is obvious today that America has defaulted on this promissory note insofar as her citizens of color are concerned. Instead of honoring this sacred obligation, America has given the Negro people a bad check, a check which has come back marked insufficient funds. But we refuse to believe that the Bank of Justice is bankrupt. We refuse to believe that there are insufficient funds in the great vaults of opportunity of this nation. So we have come to cash this check, a check that will give us, upon demand, the riches of freedom and the security of justice. We've also come to this hollow spot to remind America of the fierce urgency of now. This is no time to engage in the luxury of cooling off or to take the tranquilizing drug of gradualism. Now is the time to make real the promise of democracy. Now is the time to rise from the dark and desolate valley of segregation to the sunlit path of racial justice. Now is the time to open the doors of opportunity to all of God's children. Now is the time to lift our nation from the quicksands of racial injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood. Here ends the reading.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
For those who have used your gifts to strengthen and enrich its life. We pray for all who are called to serve in times and places of crisis, in the face of racial and social tensions. Lord, in your mercy, for the President and Congress, and for all who serve as leaders in this land, grant them, we pray, a vision of your will for your people, and wisdom to fulfill their vocation of leadership in a nation of many races. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
In the Church's proclamation of the gospel, we ask for a clear message of your love and power. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
In federal, state, and local government, for insight, integrity, and courage. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
In the administration of law and the defense of our people, for justice and humility, fairness and compassion. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
In industry and commerce, in trade and business, for mutual care and cooperation, and a concern for the good of all. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear
In education, in family and school and college, for a concern not only with information, but also with maturity and fulfillment of life. Lord, in your mercy, finally, we pray for those among us who suffer in mind, body, or spirit, especially those we now add. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, the earth is yours and the nations are your people. Take away our pride and bring to mind your goodness, so that living together in this land, we may enjoy your gifts and be thankful.
Amen. Amen. Our confession is found on page 360 of the prayer book. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Please stand as you are able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right, and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
The table of bread and wine is now made ready. It's the table of company with Jesus and all those who love him. So come to this table, you who have much faith and you who would like to have more, you who have been to this table often, and you who have not been for a long time, you who have tried to follow Jesus and you who have failed, come. It is Christ who invites us to meet him here. The gifts of God for the people of God. Thank you. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. Life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who make the journey with us. So be swift to love, and make haste to be kind. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Into the world, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.
Thanks be to God.